Thanks for sharing your garden with us. Right now, we're going to start the new year off by talking about one of my favorite January topics, and that's growing fruit here in Central Texas. We're joined by Jim Kamas, who's with the Extension Service here in Texas. He's a fruit specialist, and he works out in the Fredericksburg area, also assistant professor. Thanks so much for being with us,
You're welcome. My pleasure.
Good to have you back, I should say, on Central Texas Gardener. People love the idea of growing fruit in their yard, and we're going to be talking about some varieties that don't often pop up on everybody's radar. And I'm real excited to learn about some of the new advances and new varieties that you're working with. We're going to start off by talking about blackberries, and this is something that I know produces well in Central Texas. What are some of the latest varieties that are working for you, and what are some of the things that people could expect from trying to grow blackberries here in Central Texas?
Well, blackberries are a pretty adaptive crop. They grow best in sandy soils, but they'll do well even in our heavy caliche soils here, as long as you give them plenty of organic matter, maybe add a little additional iron. But our standard varieties start out with the old traditional 1959 A&M release Brazos. It's a tart berry, a little bit seedy, but it's the first thing that comes off. We typically will grow Rosborough, ripens about 10 days later. But our biggest advance in blackberry varieties has been one that's was released out of the University of Arkansas 7 or 8 years ago, and it's called Kiowa. Kiowa is an absolutely beautiful berry. It's very vigorous. It ripens from about the 10th of June through about the 10th of July, so it extends our traditional season. Kiowa is a huge berry. It averages 9 to 11 grams, which makes it between the size of a quarter and a ping pong ball.
Wow.
And it's got exceptional quality. So that's really been a huge addition to our thorny blackberry lineup.
Well, and it's something good for fresh eating as well as for preserves and things like that?
Oh, absolutely.
That?
Yeah, it's probably the best quality of any of the blackberries that we pick over the course of the summer.
It's hard for me to imagine a blackberry the size of a ping pong ball.
It's amazing. it doesn't take many to fill a pint.
Well, or choke a few squirrels.
Exactly.
Now, these are all the thorny varieties.
Correct.
That you referenced, and that's an important distinction. Some people really are wary of the thorny blackberries because these are kind of rambunctious shrubs, to say the least.
Well, absolutely, and especially Kiowa. It's very vigorous, and it's got wicked thorns, but with that comes some additional benefits. I mean, it's thorny varieties are usually much higher yielding than thornless. Also, you won't have the problems with birds and squirrels with the thorny varieties that you do on thornless. But they're, again, out of University of Arkansas. That's the best breeding program for blackberries in the South. We do actually have a thornless variety that's very well adapted to Central Texas, and it's called Apache. Mm-hmm. It's about a 700-hour variety, very vigorous for a thornless variety, good high-quality fruit, just not quite the big yields you'd expect out of a thorny variety.
Now, you said something that is a technical term, and we want to explain that to our audience, 700-hour variety. What does that mean?
Well, it's interesting because it wasn't until a few years ago I realized that blackberries also have chilling requirements. It's how much winter chilling, typically defined as hours at or below 45 degrees Fahrenheit over the course of a winter, a variety receives. It's important in breaking down the internal dormancy mechanisms and allowing it to fruit and grow normally in the spring.
Yeah.
If you have something too low a chilling requirement, it's typically going to break bud early and freeze out. Mm-hmm. If you have something that's too high a chilling requirement, it simply won't perform well.
Okay. Now, I understand that blackberries are all candidates for organic growers.
Absolutely. They're one of our lowest inputs. In terms of insect pests, there's really not much. Occasionally stink bugs will bother them, but for non-commercial growers, that's really not much of an issue. We do have one fungal disease that gives us problems. It's called anthracnose. It's especially bad in wet years. But dormant sprays of copper sulfate, it's organically approved, will do a good job of controlling anthracnose. That and removing the old canes after the bare fruit. That's also important.
All right. So blackberries, great candidate for Central Texas gardeners. Sounds like some really cool new varieties. Let's talk about an experiment that you have going on right now in the Fredericksburg area. You can set it up for us, but I understand you're working with a number of different fruit types for organic production.
Yes, it's adjacent to our Pears disease research facility in Fredericksburg. There was an acre that had nothing on it that needed to be planted in crops that received no insecticides. And so it gave us the opportunity to put up a small sustainable fruits planting where we have 23 varieties of new pomegranates, 46 varieties of figs, 12 varieties of pears and 7 new of the Arkansas breeding lines and the blackberries.
Okay.
So we're very excited about this.
Now, that's a lot of varieties in some of these different things. And some of these are brand new, I understand, just some of them having just entered the country for the very first time.
Well, they just came out of plant quarantine. There was a Russian scientist named Levin who spent his career exploring pomegranate germplasm in Azerbaijan and Uzbekistan and northern Iran, and this stuff came from his collection in Russia through plant quarantine, and there's been a planting established in Brownwood with a private person, and then but we have a planting in Fredericksburg for formal evaluations.
Let's take these different plants one at a time. Pomegranates are one I think of them as being a superb ornamental because the blooms are so showy, and it's a good screening plant for a lot of people. What are some of the varieties that you would recommend for people to try in their gardens?
Well, the Old Standard is wonderful, and that's the one variety we know does perform fairly well. You don't quite have the yields that you do in California. Pomegranates are a Mediterranean subtropical crop, and so when we have cold winters, we suffer freeze injury. Many times we'll have many trunks coming up from a pomegranate, and that's the really one cultural practice you can use is to try and thin some of those trunks out so that those shoots don't compete with each other for light. But other than that, right now we're still at our first growing season. We really haven't had a chance to look at this stuff fruit, so we don't really know what's going to be best.
Okay.
But we're looking for things that have cold hardiness, exceptional yield, and exceptional juice quality.
So wonderful is the variety you recommend there. I've seen another one on the market here and sold called Granada,
yes.
Which makes sense for a pomegranate.
And it's also in our planting. So that's one of the two standards we have planted to see how this will work.
Very good. Let's talk about the figs. Which varieties would you recommend for Central Texas?
Well, that depends on what you want in a fig. The traditional varieties that have very small seed size that are very creamy are Alma and Celeste. There's another sport that was collected out of near Uvalde called Lemon that is being propagated. Then there's the old traditional brown turkey or Texas Everbearing that bears well even when it gets frozen to the ground. But again, the figs that we grow really aren't the true Mediterranean type figs that are fruit. What we grow are called common figs that are simply enlarged flowers. So again, from the USDA Germplasm Repository in Davis, California, we received about 42 selections and varieties from old breeding programs in California and Hawaii, and these are all things we're really interested in giving people more alternatives than the simple three or four varieties we currently recommend.
Yeah, it's been limited, but it's fun to grow figs because they require so little intervention.
Absolutely, and even when they freeze to the ground, they typically fruit in the same year or the year following. Really no insects, no diseases. Occasionally you will have run into fig rust in wet years, but again, copper is an organic solution to that does a fine job.
Okay, another very low impact kind of fruit tree that a lot of people enjoy growing here are pears.
Absolutely. Fire blight's our enemy, so we're pretty much limited to growing fire blight tolerant pears. Fortunately, in this part of the state where we don't have a lot of rainfall, we can grow some fairly sensitive varieties. My two favorites are Warren and Ayers. But again, you have to remember we're growing perennial crops here, and sometimes varieties like Warren may take up to 8 to 10 years to come into production. So they're not very precocious, and we have to be patient. But the fruit quality certainly pays off.
Tell me about the Warren, because this is a variety I don't know that much about. What's the fruit quality like there?
It looks somewhat like a Bartlett in shape, and it typically has a red blush. So everybody's used to seeing red Bartletts. So it has a kind of a lemon ground color with a red blush on it. It's quite soft, melting flesh, and to be honest, it's better than any Bartlett I've ever eaten. Very high quality. A little bit small, 3.5-4 inches long, but superb eating quality.
Now, real briefly, a lot of people, think of fruit trees as being problematic, and it is true of things like peaches. You get the plum curculio, and a lot of the pitted fruits here do require interventions of some sort.
Yes.
But you can choose, if you're tactical about when you apply, you can use organic methods to control even those really bad pests, right?
Absolutely. I mean, for fungal diseases like brown rot, good open center pruning to increase circulation, air circulation does a long way in helping alleviate the pressure of brown rot. And as you alluded to, plum curculio, it doesn't matter if you use an insecticide that's organic or inorganic, timing's a critical point, and you need to apply those after petal fall, when the bees have quit visiting flowers, after petal fall to a phenological stage we call shuck split, when the flower actually starts to break away from the enlarging fruit, that's the time to apply insecticides to control plum curculio.
So the blossoms are off the tree.
Yes.
The bees have gone away, and you can see just the tip of that little baby fruit.
Absolutely.
And we get the shucks coming off.
Correct, and that's the time to spray for curculio.
All right, and you can use something like a rotenone product,
pyrethrin. Pyrethrins work well as well.
So
they're fairly easy to control.
So that's a great way to stay organic with fruit tree production here. And I hope that people will visit websites with the Extension Service to learn more about organic production of fruit. Jim, it's a pleasure to have you back on the show. And this is the time of year, folks. Get out there. The local nurseries will be loaded up with the fruit trees for you. So, Jim, again, a pleasure to see you again.
Thanks. Appreciate you having me back.
All right.